Hey everybody, welcome to the next SciCraft episode. Today I want to finally build up the mob farm which we designed in the last two episodes. But before we can do that, we still need to make a perimeter. So we will make a smaller one instead of going for the 528x528 version which we used for pretty much all of the witch farm perimeters. I want to go for a minimum sized farm, and that would be 17 by 17 chunks or 272 by 272. So it should be much less effort to make the small perimeter. There's still some tasks we need to do. If you watch the perimeter live streams, which we do almost every month, you already know what to do. But for everybody else, I want to quickly go through it. So I want to make this quick because most people will probably already know what to do. So here we have the so-called World Eater, and it's a two-step process machine. So on top we have a TNT tubing array, which is attached to flying machines. So we would basically create a TNT at every block, which would fall down then and explode directly on top of this stone layer here. Here at the bottom we have additionally water or lava sweepers in order to remove all of the liquids. Alright, so this machine would move from left to right, then it's pushed one block down, then from right to left, and here it's also again pushed one block down, and we would remove the blocks in the middle layer by layer. Alright, the only thing we need to make for this machine are trenches on all four sides. So on the main sides where the machine is getting pushed down, we need a 14 wide trench, and here's a 3 wide trench. Alright, so what I need to do, because this is the perimeter actually for the larger, or this is the machine for the larger perimeters, so 528x528 is making a new schematic, which is only 17 by 17 chunks. And also here in the back, I have a schematic prepared for the trenches, so which will make those trenches. I also need to adjust it. You will use those machines. Also need to make a schematic, which is smaller, because it's basically, we make trenches on all four sides, so we have a machine here in this corner going that direction and flies back. Then, like 500 blocks in this case, there's the next machine. Let's see if we can find it. It would go in that direction and so on. So we have machines on all four corners. Alright, I'm just gonna make a new schematic and then we will build it up in survival. So, we got a bit of a progress update. We're back in a survival world. And we picked a new location for the mob farm. So it was just important that we could fit a 30 by 90 mob farm completely in a desert biome, which is definitely the case with this location. So this will be the center chunk of the perimeter. And let's take a fly around. So it's the 17 by 17 chunk perimeter. It's actually kind of small perimeter for our standards by now. Usually we make the full render distance perimeter. But as I said, in this case, it's not necessary. Alright, so I made the schematics for this perimeter size. And for some reason, this always takes forever. It took me about 1 hour to make those schematics. Now we got it. So we've run the sweepers already. I live streamed for almost 4 hours. Enemy helped. And then also later, Eater and Oreo. So so we made the trenches. Was a lot of work this time because there was a lot of lava for some reason this perimeter, so we're not lucky with this location, but now it's all bucketed out and those are the trenches now. Should have maybe placed the last stupa one block lower, so bedrock level is actually one block lower, would have been better if they would have a better reach. So I think we built them at 89, next time we should do 88, would be better. We also had a bit of an issue. That was kind of stupid. So we built up our storage with all the materials to build the World Eater in the northwest corner. And those trenches, they always shoot the trenches a little bit and shoot some TNT forwards. And this unfortunately took out our main storage. So we lost all the materials for the World Eater. It was a box of sticky pistons, a box of normal pistons, a box of observers, and also I think 8 stacks of sponge, which is the worst loss. I can also maybe link a Twitch clip in the video description where you can see what happened. So I tried to save as much as possible, but unfortunately I also got blown up. Yeah, so this was the northwest corner, and we built the storage right in this position. Now we moved it over. Anyway, now it's time to continue. So we're not gonna dig the remaining layer away immediately. Maybe we'll do that afterwards. So next step is building the world eater. I want to live stream this again. If it's possible, I want to make a full time lapse of building the world eater and running it. So I will position my second account here in the center chunk and run the replay mod. I'm hoping I can additionally stream. So if it makes streaming impossible, then you won't get a time lapse. Apologize for that, but I can't really sacrifice the quality of the stream just for the time lapse. But if it works out, then you get a nice time lapse. Welcome back from the time lapse. So this was 7 minutes, but we condensed 12 hours into those 7 minutes. So I guess it's still a good ratio. It was a longer time. It's probably the longest I ever made. But yeah, a lot of stuff got done. So we finished the perimeter, and we already started placing down some slabs here in the middle, sandstone slabs, in order to make it spawn proof. So I actually have plans to make this perimeter look nice this time. Also, maybe some decoration for the farm in the middle. Because with the small size perimeter, 270 blocks by 270, it's kind of doable. We didn't do it for the last perimeters we made, so the double picture perimeters, which are 530 by 530, because it was just so overwhelming. Yeah, here even placing down all of those slabs already takes a long time. So a Norwegian artist and enemy did this. I think they spent about 3 hours on it, and it's not even finished, so it's just a lot of work to do stuff like that. And if you have to do it in a perimeter which is even 4 times larger, yeah, it becomes, I don't know, overwhelming and not really something you could do. But yeah, this time we want to make a nice perimeter. Also have something planned for the perimeter walls. Maybe we can also show that in the episode. And we also need to start taking down the old World Eater. So yeah, just mine it away. Maybe we can even try to push down the top part in order to mine it away. There's probably a way to do this. Yeah, making the perimeter went really smooth. So in total I streamed for about 12 hours, which included making a trenches, building a World Eater, and running the World Eater. So I'm, yeah, quite content. So it was mostly alone, or we were just 2 people. So Norwegian helped, and the enemy also helped, and got a little bit of help from Ether, and Ori was also online when we did the trenches. So yeah, went great. Built up the World Eater and worked immediately, and no, yeah, special occurrences in between. Had a little trouble at the bottom again because I forgot to send the or not send the station down when we were at the lowest layer on one side. So the flying machines, they bumped into. Oh, running out of elytra. Good. Then we have ender pearls. And let's change that out real quick. Okay. There we go, fresh elytra. Yeah, so those flying machines bumped into the stations because the stations went 1 block too low. By the end, it was not a big deal. So we were able to launch them again, tubers, and then we just mine out the remaining layer of stone at the bottom, which we saw in the time lapse, and sent the sweepers again. And now we have a nice and flat floor. Didn't take long. Alright, I would say let's go to creative and actually take a look at the walls I started to make. So those are the walls I want to build for the perimeter. They're inspired by that Petra site in Jordan, which you might know from Indiana Jones. So try to kept it in sandstone, but then yeah, a lot of builders complained it's too bland because I don't have any contrast in it and so on. And they started to change up the concept to make it look better. So by adding more color into it. I think here's the latest one with acacia. And I kind of have to agree. I mean, a bit of contrast is better for the eye, but I wanted to keep it actually sandstone only. So no contrast, everything should be sandstone. So we're still debating what to do. Actually preferred to just keep it all in sandstone. Even if it's not looking as great, I mean, it's just the effect of having everything into sandstone. I mean, if you think about Egypt or that area, yeah, you don't have anything built out of wood, not like here, or have those fancy decorations. Think about the pyramids or that Petra site in Jordan. It's built out of sandstone and doesn't have any fancy decoration. That's why I want to keep it similar to that. Still a bit undecided what to do. I actually tend towards keeping it, yeah, bland, not as fancy as that version. But yeah, there's still some time left to decide, I guess. Alright, so back in survival. There's still a lot of work left to do, but I will probably do that between episodes. I want to give a quick progress update about our witch farm project. Alright, update on our witch farms. So we got another completely finished perimeter now. So here we have the two witch towers, and yeah, we also have the stone field at the bottom, slime layer on top, and also the volume of blocks under the witch farms is completely filled with gravel. It's about 50,000 blocks. Also, the small volume of blocks above the witch farm is also filled with gravel. Alright, yeah, it's also fully operational, so we can turn on the witch farms here in the middle, and the drops are sent through the nether of the instant drop line to the main storage. Everything is working. What's different in that perimeter is that there's no carpet this time. The reason is, first of all, it's a lot of effort to place down carpet. So, kind of glad that we could not do that, since the slime is spawn-proof, in this case anyway. But there's another reason. We found out that carpet actually gets random ticked for no apparent reason, but it does. And this adds a slight bit of lag, so it's actually better to not have carpet there and have air blocks instead for the lag. It's actually not. Almost completely negligible. So we're talking about 0.05 MSBT for a complete layer of carpet on top of the slime. But still, since we know about it, it would actually, yeah, kind of annoy me that we have a block that lags slightly, which could prevent. So if you would decide to use maybe trapdoors instead, that would be a better block. But since it's spawn proof anyway, I think we're just gonna not do the carpeting this time. Also, kind of looks nice with the slime anyway. Alright, so this is Witch Hut 7 and 8 finished, but there's actually more. If you maybe head to the Nether, we are even starting on the next perimeter. So there's not much done at the moment. But this will be another piston bolt leading towards another double Witch Hut perimeter. Goal at the moment is to go for 16 Witch Farms in total. This is quite nice because this is relatively close to the location of the next perimeter to this site. It's just about 800 blocks away, which is really good. Normally, you would need to travel about 2,000 to 3,000 blocks per perimeter, so we're kind of glad that we got one that is, yeah, really close. Yeah, still the piston vault needs to be built. I already started on it, but yeah, this takes some time always. Alright, but yeah, there's still more to show. Let's go to the next perimeter. Witch Farm 9 and 10 is also fully operational, hooked up to the Nether and everything. So this is actually the perimeter where enemy also laid down some stone on the outside. It looks kind of interesting now with the water just flooded here. Yeah, and if you just see the size of this perimeter, you probably will understand why we don't decorate each of those perimeters completely with walls and all of that stuff, because it would just take forever. Already building those witch farms and you know, making the stone generator and so on also takes quite a few hours, so that's why we save on that. I mean, if you stand in the middle, you can't even see the walls. So there's a complete render distance perimeter, can't see any walls anyway. That's why we keep those simple. Alright, I would say one last stop. Let's go to the Witch Hut main storage and check the amount of items we already got. We've been doing some AFKing this week at 10 witch farms simultaneously. So the first column of chests is already filled up with drops. Yeah, for the sticks, we even have two columns filled up since we get double the drop rate for sticks. Maybe let's check out the redstone dust to see exactly how much we have. So we have another double chest and we have two shulker boxes and a second double chest of the second column. So this is about 700,000 redstone items. Pretty good. But yeah, we definitely want to fill it up completely, just to have a lot of blocks as well. And there's this project that requires 1 million redstone dust for yeah, making a void perimeter in order to craft a lot of pistons. So there's still more need for redstone, definitely. Alright, you probably won't do much AFKing anymore before we have 16 witch huts, since yeah, it's kind of worth it to do it when you have that. Okay, Aureus done with the map now. Pretty good. We can also check that out. Maybe in another episode at some point. It's quite impressive. But that's it for this episode. Hope you enjoyed it. We will do some work on the mob form perimeter in between episodes. So yeah, see you in the next one. Bye bye.